around the world. I'm George Howell, the CNN newsroom starts right now. AM on the U.S. East Coast, the health care law that millions of Americans have depended on, better known as Obamacare, is in danger of disappearing. Here's why. A judge in the state of Texas struck down the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare. It was a former President Barack Obama's signature piece of legislation. But through this judge's ruling, a key component of the law has been singled out as unconstitutional. And because of that, it puts the entire law in jeopardy. This is very important to point out. Despite the judge's ruling, the Affordable Care Act remains in effect while that ruling is appealed. What it means for Americans is if you want to sign up for Obamacare, you still can. The deadline, though, to do so is Saturday night. You'll remember President Donald Trump tried to repeal the legislation before. He tweeted that the ruling by a highly respected judge was not a surprise and was, quote, great news for America. In the meantime, the top Democrat in the House promises to intervene to hold what she calls the life-saving protections for people with pre-existing conditions and promises to reject the Republican effort to destroy the Affordable Care Act. Let's talk more about this now with David Katz. David, a former assistant U.S. attorney, joining us in Los Angeles this hour. A pleasure to have you here on the show, David. Thank you.
Great to be here.
Look, we've seen the Affordable Care Act survive legal challenges before. What is different this time around?
Well, after surviving numerous repeal attempts and after going to the United States Supreme Court in an earlier incarnation, this is actually a different Affordable Care Act than the one that went to the Supreme Court as the Obamacare era one. This one has the mandate, the individual mandate, removed from it as of next year. So as of next year, the judge says that this bill will be unconstitutional in its entirety because the original Obamacare was affirmed 5-4 by the U.S. Supreme Court, or upheld as being in force and being constitutional, because it was a use of the federal government's taxing power. But five justices would have said it was not proper as an exercise of the Commerce Clause. The Commerce Clause allows the federal government to affect interstate commerce, but it has to be significant. And so it was held in that case, George, that the Commerce Clause would not allow it. And so the fear now, and what has alarmed 130 million Americans with pre-existing conditions and 13 million people who signed up this year already for the Affordable Care Act, is that without the tax impact, without the individual mandate requiring people to either buy the ACA insurance or to pay a tax, that those same, they're not the same five, but that Chief Justice Roberts this time may vote to strike down the new Obamacare because it doesn't have a tax anymore. I don't agree with that analysis by the trial judge, but that's the fear that's shaking the land right now.
All right, so I just want to make sure I get this clear. So Obamacare was legal, the individual mandate was legal, and fining people who didn't purchase health care was legal. But as you're saying, once that fine was set at zero by Congress, the whole thing now becomes illegal?
This trial judge seems to believe that the Republicans in Congress this last year, when Obamacare, quote, survived, that actually the Republicans had booby-trapped it, and that by making there be no mandate that was enforced by the tax laws, that they would strip it of its only constitutional basis, which was the taxing power. And so although McCain dramatically voted against it and the major repeal did not happen, apparently it was, at least for this judge in Texas, booby-trapped in a way that the whole thing was unconstitutional. Now, whether the Republicans were really that clever or whether this particular trial judge, he's a go-to conservative judge who's ruled, he's from the George W. Bush, he's ruled against Obamacare previously. So he was the dream judge for the state attorneys general who are challenging the ACA. We'll have to see whether it ever survives in the Court of Appeals and we'll have to see whether it ever survives in the U.S. Supreme Court.
David, you know, we did get this statement from the White House. We'll put it here at full screen. We expect this ruling, it says, will be appealed to the Supreme Court. Pending the appeal process, the law remains in place. David, from your legal perspective, how do you see this playing out? What's the timeline?
Well, I think that it will take a while. You know, what's going on now is that the House of Representatives, once it's Democratic, to be Speaker Pelosi, has indicated that the Democrats will join the lawsuit, move to intervene in it. It already has 12 to 16 state attorneys general who are going to be appealing it, including the state of California. It's enormously important to the health of Californians that Obamacare not be struck down by the higher courts. And then if it gets appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court, everyone's going to be biting their fingernails to see what Chief Justice Roberts is going to do. And there are ways to affirm to uphold the validity of the ACA, even with the revisions that were made to it. I believe Chief Justice Roberts will in the end. I don't believe that the ACA is going to fall. And in the interim, until the U.S. Supreme Court might say that it's invalid, I don't see any reason why it's going to be changed. I don't see the Democrats in the House agreeing to anything that the Republicans and Trump would want in the Senate. So as a practical matter, I think it'll stay in effect until and unless the U.S. Supreme Court, with Chief Justice Roberts casting the fifth vote, strikes it down. If that happens, all H will break loose.
David Katz, we appreciate your time. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Moving on now to the Russia investigation. CNN has learned the special counsel Robert Mueller still wants to speak with President Trump, but Mr. Trump's attorneys are dead set against that happening. Our Pamela Brown has details now for you from Washington, D.C.
Special Counsel Robert Mueller's team continues to be interested in interviewing the president. Two sources familiar with the matter tell me. Now, Mueller's stance on interviewing the president has been constant for a year and a half. We are told nothing has changed in that sense from the first day, the sources said. The president and his lawyers are still very much opposed to any potential interview. The president's legal team have resumed some discussion with special counsel, in the weeks since the president responded to written questions, mostly regarding collusion and the time period before the inauguration, these sources said. And the two sides had agreed to hold off on discussing any interview while the president wrote responses to the questions, which were returned just before Thanksgiving. That was seen as a first step to concluding more than a year of back and forth between the two sides, and the president's lawyers had hoped would bring Mueller closer to finishing his probe. But we are told Mueller's interest in talking with the president continues, and it includes an interest in asking questions about the president's state of mind in regards to actions under scrutiny in the obstruction probe. There has been no indication Mueller is moving to subpoena the president, one of these sources said, and asked if Mueller has had follow-up questions to the president's written responses. The source declined to comment. Now, the president's attorney, Rudy Giuliani, reiterated that opposition to me on any potential interview, stressing the mistrust by the president's lawyers of Mueller's aggressive investigation. In their view, he said, "I am pretty disgusted with them." The Office of the Special Counsel declined to comment. Pamela Brown, CNN, Washington.
Pamela, thank you. Now to the president's former attorney and fixer, who's breaking his silence after pleading guilty to multiple felonies. Michael Cohen has been sentenced to 3 years in prison. He now says publicly that Mr. Trump knew that it was wrong when he directed hush money payments to two women before the election. My colleague Jim Acosta has this report.
It was fixating TV as President Trump's former fixer, Michael Cohen, explained that federal prosecutors don't see his flip as a flop.
The special counsel stated emphatically that the information that I gave to them was credible and helpful. There's a substantial amount of information that they possess that corroborates the fact that I am telling the truth.
In an interview with ABC, Cohen pushed back on the president's claim that he didn't issue an order to make hush money payments to a porn star and Playboy model alleging affairs with Mr. Trump.
Let me tell you, I never directed him to do anything wrong. Whatever he did on his own.
Giving direction, Cohen insisted, is what the president always did as a businessman.
Nothing at the Trump Organization was ever done unless it was run through Mr. Trump. He directed me.
As for the president's claims he didn't commit any crimes, Cohen noted the critical timing of the payments just before the 2016 election.
You have to remember at what point in time that this matter came about, 2 weeks or so before the election, post the Billy Bush comments. So yes, he was very concerned about how this would affect the election.
Despite all of the investigations now touching the Trump Organization, Foundation, Campaign, Inauguration, Transition, and Administration, the White House is brushing off Cohen's comments, saying they shouldn't be taken seriously.
He's a self-admitted liar. You guys all know that. And for him to say, I'm going to stop lying now, is somewhat silly.
But cracks may be starting to form under the president's feet. Consider those GOP lawmakers all but lining up to back the president earlier this week, as Senator Orrin Hatch did with CNN's Manu Raju.
The Democrats will do anything to hurt this president.
But this is not the Democrats. This is the Southern District of New York.
I don't care. All I can say is he's doing a good job as president.
Hatch released a statement saying he regretted those remarks, adding, I made comments about allegations against the president that were irresponsible and a poor reflection on my lengthy record of dedication to the rule of law. As for the other reality show unfolding at the White House, the president dangled a bright, shiny object, selecting his budget director, Mick Mulvaney, as his new acting chief of staff. One other top contender, New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, had pulled himself out of the running earlier in the day, saying in a statement, it's an honor to have the president consider me as he looks to choose a new White House chief of staff. However, I've told the president that now is not the right time for me or my family to undertake this serious assignment. It was always a stretch to see Christie in that role, given his criticism of the president for hiring family members for key posts.
The situation is made much worse by the fact that when you have family members in the White House, it makes it much more difficult. And there were many of us who counseled the president, not just about Jared, but about any other members of his family having official positions.
One thing is clear in this photo tweeted this week showing former Chief of Staff Ryan Priebus and the outgoing John Kelly. They both look much happier. And it's no surprise with his former fixer Michael Cohen dominating this news cycle that the president would try to throw out a bright, shiny object on this late Friday. And he's done just that, selecting his budget director, Mick Mulvaney, as an acting chief of staff, replacing the outgoing John Kelly. Jim Acosta, CNN, the White House.
Jim, thank you. We're following events in France, that nation bracing to our viewers here in the United States and all around the world. You are watching CNN Newsroom live from Atlanta. I'm George Howell with the headlines we're following for you this hour. Legislation that brought health care to millions of Americans has been struck down by a U.S. judge in Texas. He ruled that parts of the Affordable Care Act, better known as Obamacare, are unconstitutional, and to that end, the entire plan must go. That law remains in effect for now. Very important to point that out. An appeal is, though, expected. CNN has learned special counsel Robert Mueller still wants to speak with President Trump about possible obstruction of justice. Mr. Trump has previously answered written questions from the special counsel. Trump's attorney, Rudy Giuliani, says he's against it because they don't trust Robert Mueller. President Trump has chosen Mick Mulvaney to be his acting chief of staff. Mulvaney is currently the director of the Office of Management and Budget. He'll keep that job as well. The current chief of staff, John Kelly, is leaving at the end of the year. Britain's Labour Party is calling for a Brexit vote in Parliament before Christmas. This after the Prime Minister there, Theresa May, failed to gain concessions from the EU in Brussels on Brexit. Downing Street says a vote could take place in January, but the EU is skeptical that her deal will be approved and is moving ahead with plans for a hard Brexit. Let's get back to the latest on a developing story that we're following here in the United States. A federal judge in Texas has ruled that the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, is unconstitutional. The legislation has been controversial since its beginning. Here's a look back now at how that law came into being.
If you like your doctor, you will be able to keep your doctor, period. If you like your health care plan, you will be able to keep your health care plan, period.
On this vote, the yeas are 220, the nays are 211. The bill is passed.
Today, after almost a century of trying, today, after over a year of debate, today, After all the votes have been tallied, health insurance reform becomes law in the United States of America.
Liberty, yes. Obamacare, no. Liberty, yes. Obamacare, no.
Hey, hey, Obamacare is here to stay. Ho, ho. Hey, hey, Obamacare is here to stay.
The first order of business is to repeal and replace Obamacare.
We came very close, but we did not get that consensus. That's why I thought the wise thing to do is not proceed with a vote.
People are hurting. Inaction is not an option. And frankly, I don't think we should leave town unless we have a health insurance plan.
On this vote, the yeas are 45, the nays are 55. The amendment is not agreed to.
Let's get some perspective now on the politics of Obamacare with Natasha Lindstedt. Natasha, a professor of government at the University of Essex, joining via Skype this hour. A pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you.
The U.S. president, as you'll recall, has promised to repeal and replace Obamacare. Conservatives who've been pushing to see this law struck down, they are certainly excited about this ruling. But as a party, they've struggled to come together on how to replace the law. Let's take it one step at a time. What does this mean for the U.S. president if the law is simply repealed but not replaced?
Well, for Trump and the Republicans that have been very critical of Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, if it is just repealed, and of course there's going to be a huge fight and appeals process that will eventually go to the Supreme Court, but if it is just repealed, then the Republicans promised that they would come up with some sort of replacement plan. But as Trump has even noted himself, healthcare is very, very complicated, and it's not that easy to just come up with a replacement plan. It takes years and a lot of expertise. And there's a real danger that if this plan goes forward, you have, you know, over 130 million Americans that have pre-existing conditions. And Obamacare was vital to ensuring that anyone that had a pre-existing condition would be covered. You also had 20% of Americans that prior to the passage of the Affordable Care Act that weren't insured. And so if the Republicans get their way and this gets repealed, they're going to be actually in more trouble because you have 75% of Americans that are in favor of having some plan in place that ensures that anyone with a pre-existing condition is taken care of.
Look, this certainly, however you slice it, plays into the president's promise, one of the big campaign promises that he had. And, of course, he tweeted about it. Let's pull the tweet up if we have it full screen. As he says, as I predicted all along, Obamacare has been struck down as unconstitutional, a disaster. Now Congress must pass a strong law that provides great health care and protects pre-existing conditions. Mitch and Nancy, get it done. The president talking about the soon-to-be-led Democratic House of Representatives. With this Congress, under this president, is there a chance, Natasha, that this law might find a path forward even as it faces these challenges in court?
No, I don't think so. I mean, the House Democrats have been very assertive with the fact that health care is the biggest issue over the midterms. It was going to be their big issue that they were going to campaign on. And they want to keep the aspects of Affordable Care Act in place and just improve upon it. They have no desire to repeal it and to start from scratch. That doesn't really make any sense. What would make sense would be to work on improving the problems with Obamacare that people have, that possibly the premiums are a little bit too high for people who are young and healthy. And there's got to be other things that they should be looking at as well. The fact that U.S. government pays twice as much as other countries for healthcare with results that are subpar. We have lower life expectancy rates compared to other countries of similar incomes and higher infant mortality rates. We have incredibly high administrative costs to process medical claims. These are all things that can be improved upon, including also lowering drug costs, rather than start from scratch and come up with something new. That just doesn't make any sense.
Let's cover this topic because, you know, we're certainly talking about this ruling from the state of Texas that throws this law into question now. But important to point out that Americans still have access to this particular law. It's not gone away. It's still there for them, but there is a deadline on Saturday.
Right. And that's what people have been emphasizing, the fact that it hasn't been completely eradicated. But there is a deadline that people need to sign up for it. And then they're going to have to wait and see what happens with the process of appeals. And there's certainly going to be appeals. There are many states that have already said that they were going to be appealing and that it would go to the Supreme Court. And if you look at what happened based on 2012, where the Supreme Court basically ruled in favor of sustaining the Affordable Care Act, though it may be a slightly different situation this time because it's a little bit more of a conservative court, legal experts are claiming that the appeals process is likely to go in favor of maintaining the Obamacare.
Natasha Lindstedt, thank you again for taking time and giving perspective. We'll keep in touch with you.
Thank you.
Australia's prime minister has announced that his government now recognizes West Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. Let's get the latest now live from Jerusalem. Our Ian Lee covering the story. And Ian, what is the reaction in Israel, and is there a surprise here?
Well, we're waiting to see what the reaction will be from the Israelis, George. It is Shabbat right now. Been told that that reaction will probably come later in the day. As far as the Palestinians are concerned, they were expecting that the Australian government would declare all of Jerusalem the capital of Israel, not just the western part of the city. But with this declaration, where the Australians are recognizing only West Jerusalem, that does, the Palestinians believe, show that there is pressure on the Australian government not to make the full declaration of the entirety of Jerusalem. And also, you look at that statement from the Australians, they are saying that the eastern part of Jerusalem could be the future capital of a Palestinian state, and that they support the two-state solution, and that the final status of Jerusalem will be determined through that peace process. The prime minister defended his move. Here's what he had to say.
Fundamentally, it's the right of every country to determine its national capital. That is why the government I lead asked the question. He's asked the question about the position we have long adopted in relation to Jerusalem.
So, George, before the United States made its declaration, the international community at large saw Jerusalem as a city that will be determined through negotiations between the Israelis and Palestinians. Initially, when Jerusalem was designated as a international city by the UN back in 1947, that designation really hasn't changed for most of the international community, although you have had some countries make certain declarations. Although Israel says that all of Jerusalem is their capital, the Palestinians want to see the eastern part of their future capital. But when you do look at what this means, at least for on the ground, it does show that the Australians are determining the western side. The Russians did that last year. And so it does keep that line that does separate the line that they say separates the east and west, George.
All right. Ian Lee, thank you for the background and the reporting. We'll stay in touch. Next here on News. In the Netherlands, a 21-year-old American student who was stabbed to death, allegedly by her roommate, well, police found Sarah Papenheim after they received reports of a dispute in her apartment. The 23-year-old roommate has been arrested. Let's get the very latest this hour from Salma Abdelaziz, following the story in our London bureau. What is the latest on this investigation?
George, Sarah Papenheim should have been on her way to Minnesota for Christmas next week. Instead, she was tragically found stabbed to death in her apartment in Rotterdam. Police say there was a quarrel in her apartment. By the time authorities arrived on the scene, it was too late to save the 21-year-old. The primary suspect is her male roommate, a 23-year-old man she met in the Netherlands and befriended over their shared love of music. But her mother tells local news she long worried about the instability of the young man and had even warned her daughter away from him.
He'd have highs and lows, and she noticed that, and we had talked, and I told her she needed to get out of there because something ain't right.
Her mother went on to tell local news she's cried so much her tear ducts are dry. And Sarah's local community in the Twin Cities has also been tragically heartbroken over this at the Christmas season. She was an aspiring young musician. Her friends called her Thumper because she was so good on the drums. And it's the second time the Pappenheim family has seen loss. Sarah's brother died of suicide just 3 years ago. That inspired the young woman to travel to the Netherlands and study psychology at Erasmus University, where unfortunately she lost her life, George.
So, Abdelaziz, thank you for the reporting. We'll keep in touch on it. Still ahead, delegates at the COP24 International Climate Conference in Poland. They're struggling to agree after almost 2 weeks of talks. Talks continue into the weekend as delegates from nearly 200 countries meet in Poland for the COP24 Climate Conference. They've been trying to flesh out a guidebook on how to implement the Paris Climate Agreement that was reached 3 years ago. The two-week talks were supposed to end on Friday, but disputes remain on how to execute a plan to limit global warming. Our Nick Payton-Walsh has more on this from Poland.
On paper, it was supposed to really have concluded by now, but we are into extra time here, really, at COP24. Vital talks to establish the technical framework, the technical terms of how countries that have agreed in Paris in 2015 to radically reduce their greenhouse gas emissions, how they will transparently audit themselves, and possibly who will pay any recompensation for people, for countries that have been damaged by climate change. Now, we are hearing conflicting signals. We were supposed to, at some point tonight, have heard an update from leaders here about how the talks are going, and perhaps later in the night there may emerge an updated draft text of this agreement. But the task ahead of them is extraordinarily complex. Over 100 separate nation states have to effectively agree to an incredibly complicated technical framework as to how they will essentially alter their national economies, how they will limit fossil fuel use. And that has not been helped by the broader tone of the past week or so, altered by last weekend, the United States, Russia, Saudi Arabia and Kuwait essentially rejecting a key scientific report about the likely damage to do the global climate in the next decade. And then the US on Monday launching a side event to promote fossil fuel use. That has led some to doubt whether there's the international broad consensus here to make real progress. There are concerns that potentially the final framework they settle upon will be too weak, will be too relaxed and allow too much wriggle room for countries to actually genuinely be forced into openly reducing their emissions. There are some suggestions too that while the US is publicly acting as a spoiler behind the scenes, it's simply allowing the technical work to go ahead. But extra time really here. Constant delays in updates and concerns of a lot of heavy lifting to be done before we finally see some kind of agreement, if at all. Nick Payton-Walsh, CNN, Katowice.
Nick Payton-Walsh, thank you. Now to the United States, where a strong storm system is soaking the southeast and mid-Atlantic, bringing with it severe storms and excessive rain and flooding. Our meteorologist, Ivan Cabrera, is here to tell us more about it. It is going to be a wet, soggy time.
Yeah, and we know all about it here in the south. It continues to rain incredibly. So, and I tell you what, the snow that fell the Carolinas last week, that's going to be involved here as well. I want to take you to South Carolina, though, or Charleston. As take a look at that. That's a difficult Friday. Folks trying to get around, having a hard time doing so. And once again, I think today we're under the gun for some significant rain. A good thing is this is not going to be like the last storm here that we're talking about, big snow across areas that typically don't see that much. But the flood threat is going to be there because of that snow that fell and because of the heavy rain that's going to be on the way. And those two are going to get together. And it's not going to be a good result at all here. There is the area of low pressure there right over the south. But you see the moisture just getting pumped in from south to north. I'm calling it a southern storm because that's where it's originating, but it's not going to stay in the south. It's going to head up to the mid-Atlantic and eventually in the northeast, and we'll watch that. Severe weather rolled through Florida. That's beginning to diminish now, but look at all the moisture just continuing to stream on in, pinwheeling around that area of low pressure. just to the west, and we'll continue to see that rain up into D.C. as well. So over 25 million now under a flood, either watch or a warning here because of the heavy rain. We're talking from Charleston, where I showed you those pictures, through North Carolina and all the way into D.C. And again, here, 1 to 4 inches of rainfall. That is going to combine with what we have on the ground, which is some snowfall, and incredibly, not in the north, right, across the south here. And so this snow will be gone by the time we get into Sunday and into Monday. But the way it's going to be gone, it's just going to melt because the rain is just going to chew through it. And I tell you, once that happens, it's going to get into the river and streams, and we could be seeing some significant flooding as a result. There is the rain that we're expecting as we head into Saturday and Sunday. And follow the track here, because I have one more threat additionally on top of the flood. Once we get into Saturday night, I think the air is going to be cold.